Good morning, Eagle Heights Cathedral, and welcome to today's Sunday celebration service. We are thrilled beyond measure to be back worshiping with you, not just on live stream, but also in person. You can join us in person by registering at ehconline.org for one of three services at 8:30, 10:15, and 12 p.m. Registrations open tomorrow at midnight. Now join us for Bishop Collins' continuing message, Vision Beyond 2020, Becoming a Giant Killer.
Good morning, Eagle Heights family. Praise God. Hallelujah. Can we put our hands together? Come on, we can do better than that. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let me pray. Father, we give you glory, honor, and praise. Father God, take over this atmosphere. We surrender. Father, we come with heart surrendering. Father, open ears, open eyes, open hearts to receive your word, dear God. Father, I pray that we leave not as we came in. May the anointing of your spirit, Father God, Father, use our bishop like you always do. Use him, dear God. Father, speak to our lives. We need counsel, wisdom, your direction. And so, Father, we give you glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Can somebody say amen?
Well, praise the Lord, church. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I'm going to ask you to turn with me directly in your Bibles to 1 Samuel 17. And we're going to walk through some verses together in 1 Samuel 17. Let me begin, though, by telling you this. This is a true story about a man called and named Larry Walters. At 33 years of age, Larry decided that he wanted to see his neighborhood from a different perspective. So he goes down to the Army Navy store and he purchases 45 weather balloons. That afternoon, he strapped himself into a lawn chair to which several of his friends tied the now filled helium balloons. He took along a six pack, a peanut butter sandwich, and a BB gun, figuring he could shoot the balloons one at a time when he was ready to land. Larry thought that the balloons would lift him about 100 or so feet into the air. But when he was cut loose, the chair soared 10,000 feet into the sky, smack dab into the middle of the air traffic pattern for the Los Angeles airport. He was too frightened to shoot out any of the balloons, stayed in the air for more than 2 hours, forcing the airport to shut down its runways, causing long delays on flights. After he was safely back on the ground and sighted by police, reporters asked him three questions. Were you scared? Yes. Would you do it again? No. Why did you do it? Because, Larry said, you can't just sit there. With that in mind, I want to remind you today that this is the year where God speaks to us. This is the year where we need to comprehend that what we need most in our lives to be governed by is the power of spiritual vision. This is the year that you've got to make up your mind that no matter what comes your way, no matter what giants or Goliaths you face, that you will not just sit there and take what the devil throws at you. For we must not simply have vision, church. We must have the kind of mindset that says that I'm going to act on vision when God gives it to me. Let me get something out of the way immediately this morning. Some of you are going to have to rid your minds of the dangerous and untrue belief that where you are today in life, that it's too late. You've got to remedy your mind that it's not too dark or that you've not gone too far down the wrong road to ever see visions and dreams come to pass, because some of you have been holding on to visions that God gave you years ago and you've just about given up on them. I want you to listen to the Holy Spirit. We're going to talk in a few moments about how to recognize and then rid our lives of what I call vision killers, because some of you, your problem has been that you have had the wrong voices speaking in your ears. And here's some of the tragedy. Many times the wrong voice has been our own voice. Watch this now. It may be that your own vision killer has been you. But before we go there, listen to this from Max Lucado. Mark 5:36 says, but Jesus paid no attention to what they said. Listen to what Max says about this scripture. He says, I love that line. It describes the critical principle for seeing the unseen. Ignore what people say. Block them out. Turn them off. Close your ears. And if you have to, walk away. Ignore the ones who say it's too late to start over. Disregard those who say you'll never amount to anything. Turn a deaf ear toward those who say that you aren't smart enough or big enough, fast enough, tall enough. Ignore them. Faith sometimes begins by stuffing your ears with cotton. Jesus turns immediately to Jairus and he pleads, don't be afraid, just believe. Jesus compels Jairus to see the unseen. When Jesus says, just believe, he is imploring, don't limit your possibilities to the visible. Don't listen only to the audible. Don't be controlled by the logical. Believe there is more to life than meets the eye. Trust me, Jesus is pleading. Don't be afraid, just trust. Bill Bright made this statement. The way each day will look to you all starts with who you are looking to. Psalm 121:1-2. David said, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from which cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. Now, it is already established, we all understand that we are living in uncertain times, that there's a lot of stress, there's difficulty, confusion, and downright evil. But you need to really, really get this in your spirit. You cannot and you must not put your trust in the government. It behooves me to encourage you this day to make up your minds that you will lift up your eyes to the hills from which come your help. All your help comes from the Lord. And I am convinced that if we will do that, that God will give us vision for every circumstance and every giant that we will face in this coming year. And David said, here is why I place my confidence only in him. He is the Lord who made heaven and earth. Because God made heaven and earth, he knows what's going on in the earth. And since he knows what's going on in the earth, you don't have to worry, because God has promised when you look to the hills and look straight in his eyes, he will give you vision and eyesight to deal with every situation, every Goliath, every giant that comes into your life. And one more thing, I want everyone to understand that when I speak of not putting your faith and trust in the government, please understand that I am not anti-government, nor will I go as far as to say, as some people have said, that our government is corrupt. What I will say is this. There are some corrupt people in government. There are some corrupt people in business. There are some corrupt people in banking. There are some corrupt people in law enforcement, and on in every area of life. Listen to me, church. There are some corrupt people in the ministry. And because there is corruption in every field and endeavor, as a child of God, you must not and you cannot put your faith and trust in man. And I'm going to say it one more time. Even men at our best, we are still just men. Your faith and your trust must be in the one who uses the many to meet and supply all your needs according to his riches in glory. Now, as we go into today's message, let me once again set the stage for this series. David starts out serving his father as a shepherd. He is watching over his father's flock, and eventually he becomes a psalmist to King Saul with the anointing and the power to break demonic spirits that are tormenting Saul's soul. His three brothers had followed King Saul as soldiers into battle against the Philistines. And one day David's father says to him, I've cooked a meal. Take this home-cooked meal to your brothers. And then he also says to him, and come back and give me a report of how the war is going. When David arrives there, he sees there the army of the God of Israel, of which his brothers are a part of. He watches them slip into their war gear. They line up, they run toward the battle line, and they cry a war cry, only to immediately after that retreat and go back into their tent. The Bible says that they did this for 40 days. As David is speaking with his brothers, he sees a giant of a man named Goliath, who comes out of the line of the family of giants and to the army of Israel. And the Bible says he stands on the edge and he says what he's been saying for the last 40 days. He says, choose a man from among your midst who is not afraid to fight me. Send him down here. If he defeats me, we will be your slaves. If the reverse happens, well, you know how this will end. And I remind you again today, you must have a visual picture that Goliath is not some little tiny man. There is a reason he is called a giant. He stands in the neighborhood of 9 feet 9 inches tall. Now listen to me, church. In the natural, you could see why the army would not put their destiny in the hand of one member of their army. Let me say that again because it's going to be important in a minute. You can see in the natural why this army would not put their destiny in the hand of one member of their army. And every day Goliath taunted them, challenged them to send out a man to fight him. Now, what I want you to see is this. David could not comprehend why no one would challenge that giant. He could not wrap his mind around the reality that the soldiers, whose God was the living God, were afraid of a man, no matter how big he is, whose God was a dead God. In short of the story, David is a teenager who did what grown war-trained men were afraid to do. He got a vision and he conquered the giant. And don't miss this. When he did it, he saved the whole nation of Israel. I have said this on more than one occasion and I repeat it again today. We are going to find out more so than ever before that vision is going to be important in our lives. But we must comprehend that our vision is not just our vision. It is not about us. There are other people's destinies tied to our visions. Fathers have got to comprehend that your children, their destiny is tied to your vision. Your grandchildren's destiny is tied to your vision. And so we began to talk about the characteristics of a giant killer. We learned that number one, giant killers are not born, they are made. Number two, giant killers rarely look like giant killers. Number three, giant killers reach great victories by building on small victories. Number four, we learn that giant killers visualize victory before going after the giant. And five, giant killers refuse to allow what has been as an excuse to not pursue what can be. Now, get this in your spirit. All giant killers are visionaries. And all visionaries must become giant killers. But every person with a vision does not see that vision come to pass, because though they had a vision, they did not see the fruition of that vision because they never developed the nature and the characteristics of a giant killer. And watch this now. The first place you have got to start in order to become a giant killer is to rid your life of vision killers, of which, I repeat, you may be your own vision killer. Listen now. The vision killers I speak of, some manifest themselves through other people, but yet some manifest themselves through your own attitudes, beliefs, and habits. So what are the characteristics of vision killers? Well, number one, vision killers are common. They are common. Listen to me now. Vision killers are a dime a dozen. Look at 1 Samuel 17, 16, and then 20 through 21. 16 says, and the Philistine drew near morning and evening and presented himself for 40 days. Verse 20 says, and David rose up early in the morning and he left the sheep with the keeper, and he took and he went as Jesse had commanded him, and he came to the trench as the host was going forth to fight and shouted for the battle, for Israel and the Philistines had put the battle in array, army against army. Now, that phrase in array is very important. What that literally meant was this. There was a lot of fist shaking and threats, mostly by Goliath, yet there were no takers for any battle. There was just words and words and words, as though they were working themselves all up only to perform no action. Let me tell you about these dime a dozen vision killers. They do two things. They talk a good game and do nothing, and then they talk about you when you try to do something. Watch now. That covers a whole lot of people, a whole lot of society, and surely a whole lot of Christians. These guys didn't want to do anything, but they just can't be miserable by themselves. They want to make sure that you are not successful. They will criticize you. They want to make sure that you also don't do anything. We saw this in the case of David's older brother, Eliab. He didn't want to do anything about the threat, but he talked about David like a dog when he wanted to do something about Goliath. Now watch this. It dawned on me that it wasn't just a man or two that lacked courage to go out there and take out the big boy. We're talking about a whole army full of soldiers, thousands of trained men of war. It is said that at one time, Saul commanded an army of 80,000 men of war. And yet among them, there was not one who had the courage. Listen to me. What we are witnessing here is the power of peer pressure. Watch it now. Eliab was one of 1,000 soldiers that were trained under the father Jesse, who was sent. He was a key voice in Saul's leadership in his army. And there was no doubt in my mind that the negativity that he unloaded on David was just fruit of what he had been unloading on those men before David came. This attitude that said, we can't take this giant. In fact, what in the world are we doing down here anyway? And I am telling you that there are some serious peer pressure that is going on here. Pastor Chuck Swindoll tells of a test that was conducted by a university where 10 students were placed in a room. 3 lines of varying length were drawn on a card. The students were told to raise their hands when the instructor pointed to the longest line, but 9 of the 10 students had been instructed beforehand to only raise their hands when the instructor pointed to the second longest line. Then they set one guy up to be the stooge. And watch, the usual reaction of the stooge was to put his hand up, look around, and then once he realized he was alone, he would pull his hand back down. Watch what happened. Watch this now. This happened 75% of the time with the students from grade school through high school. The researchers concluded that many would rather be president than be right. Here's what I don't want you to miss. Peer pressure happens among adults as well. We will accept what we even know to be wrong if it means standing alone. We are, listen to me, church, a majority-driven society. Listen now, there were people, and I'm saying this with love, who were engaging in protest in 2020. They had no clue what for. They were just engaging because there was a majority in their mind doing so. Listen to me. I say this with love. There were people who were marching. They were protesting. They were tearing up stuff because of racism, who until that moment could have cared less about racism. But since people were wanting to be in the majority and be politically correct, they engaged in something that they did not understand. And here comes the problem. Now that things have kind of dialed down, they could care less because they were moving under peer pressure, not concern. It has been since biblical times, for it was the majority that yelled crucify concerning Jesus. Here's the question we want to answer. How do you go from trailing the King of Glory while he's riding on a donkey and singing Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, to within a few short hours yelling, crucify the man? Let me tell you how it goes there. It's called peer pressure. And peer pressure is why many vision killers are a dime a dozen. They're common, but watch me now. What you've got to understand is that peer pressure also has the power to work in reverse. If you are ever going to see your visions come to pass, you must come to the place where even if it means standing in the stream alone sometimes, do it. Because watch this now. Once David defeated Goliath, listen to verses 50 through 52. So David prevailed over the Philistines with a sling and with a stone and smote the Philistine and slew him. But there was no sword in David's hand. Therefore David ran and stood upon the Philistine and took his sword. And he drew it out of the sheath thereof, and he slew him, and he cut off his head therewith. And when the Philistines saw their champion was dead, they fled. But watch what happened to God's army. And the men of Israel and Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines until they came to the valley and to the gates of Ekron. And the wounded of the Philistines fell down by way of Shearim and even Gath and unto Ekron. Listen now. And the children of Israel returned from chasing after the Philistines, and they spoiled their tents. They filled their tents up with the things and the riches that they had confiscated from the Philistines. Pay attention to what I'm about to say. Up until that moment, there had been not any man in that army who had the courage, though they had the potential, to take Goliath out. But once they saw David rise up with courage, all of a sudden courage was invested in them. Peer pressure had suddenly reversed. Listen to me. And the reason they couldn't do it was that they did not possess what David possessed. David based his vision on who he knew and what he knew about who he knew, not on what the naysayers were saying, not on what the vision killers were saying. And if you are going to conquer giants in your life that come your way, you must rid your life of people who fall into the commonality of being vision killers. You don't have to be rude. You just need to stuff your ears with cotton and walk away and don't listen. Amen. Number two, vision killers are complacent. Complacent. 1 Samuel 17:29b. And David said, is there no cause? Listen now, those soldiers in Saul's army, they were satisfied just to get through every day, put on their uniforms, march around in military format, yelling the war cry as long as the actual war did not take place. Watch now. And they were willing to allow God, not allow Goliath, not to only insult them, but insult Almighty God. As long as they were safe and secure. That sounds like the Church of Jesus Christ to me. Preachers are willing to allow the world to insult God rather than stand in the pulpit and tell the truth. Listen to me. This had gone on for so long that they became so complacent that it no longer mattered. They had that attitude, we can just do this for the rest of our days because at least we are staying alive. And what they didn't get and what you and I must get was that complacency was doing what it always does. It was lulling and luring them into a false sense of safety and security. Really hear the question that David asked. He says, what? Why are you all so complacent? Is there nothing here that demands your immediate, undivided, unwavering attention? Is there nothing worth laying down your life for? Dr. Martin Luther King says, until you have something that is worth laying down your life for, you are not really alive. Now let me say something very important before we go forward. When Christians don't want to accept something or do something, we not only become very spiritual, but we can somehow find the scripture to back up our unwillingness to deal with our issues. And the first thing that someone will want to do when you talk about complacency, in order to justify where they are in whatever condition they're in, is to pull out Philippians 4:11, where Paul says, not that I speak of want, for I have learned in whatever state I am, therewith to be content. Listen to me. Some people are in the mess they are in because they never learned to be content. No matter what state they were in, Massachusetts or any other one. That was free. But here's what I'm really driving at. We Christians are bad about using scripture in order to just stay where we are, accepting whatever life throws at us. Well, Bishop, didn't the Bible say be content? Well, let me explain to you the difference between content and being complacent. One well-known TV personality said, be thankful for what you have. You'll end up having more. If you concentrate on what you don't have, you will never, ever have enough. Let me talk about contentment. Contentment comes from appropriate satisfaction, gratitude, and acceptance. Content person will continue striving hard to achieve more, but will be grateful for what he or she has. He won't do things, listen to me, church, just to prove something to someone else. When you are discontent, you will go out, you will buy a car you cannot afford to impress people you don't know who don't care about who you are. Let me talk to you for a minute. But on the flip side, it is important to understand that just because someone's content with their career or their relationship or things in their life, it does not mean that they shouldn't want more. It does not mean that he or she should not reach out. And some people, we criticize people for wanting more as being worldly and lusting after the things that only satisfy the flesh. Let me tell you what I've seen in this world. You can be as poor as Job's turkey and still lust for only things that please the flesh. As long as you are obeying Matthew 6:33, as long as you're seeking the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness first, there is nothing wrong with you desiring more than what you have right now in your life, but you got to learn to be content. What is complacency? Benjamin Mays on complacency says this: the tragedy of life is often not in our failure, but rather in our complacency. Not in our doing too much, but rather in our doing too little. Not in our living above our ability, but rather in our living below our capacities. Listen to me now. Complacency comes from laziness, lack of ambition, and a false satisfaction. A complacent person will turn a blind eye to all the troubles and act as if everything is perfectly all right. He will keep waiting for things to happen rather than making them happen. Listen to me now. Why so many can succumb to complacency, even when they would desire deep down inside a better situation in life, is one word: fear. Now watch this. Joseph Borowick wrote an article on complacency, safety's worst enemy. He said the danger of complacency is that it gives a false sense of security. Now, he was speaking of safety in the workplace, but this is also true in life. When we become complacent, we adopt the attitude that says everything is just fine the way it is. He said complacency occurs when you've been doing something one way for so long without incident that you assume there can never be an incident. Now, let me repeat something. I've said it before, assumption is the lowest form of knowledge. I remind you of that family that lost their elderly mother and father to COVID. Those kids had stayed away from their family, their mother and father, for a whole year. They desired to keep them healthy, and they assumed that just this one time, one short get-together won't hurt. And that one moment of complacency, the mother and father contracted COVID and died. And they came on national TV to warn all of us about the danger of becoming complacent in this battle with COVID. I am constantly reminding my staff, be careful, be careful, be careful. You see, complacency can lull you into a place of false security. And so it is when it comes to your life and having a vision for your life. If you are not careful, church, complacency will cause you not only to suffer some devastating losses, but it will cause you to just settle for whatever life and the devil throws at you because of fear. Someone said complacency is a blight that saps energy, dulls attitudes, and causes a drain on the brain. The first symptom is satisfaction with the way things are. The second is rejection of things that might be. Good enough becomes today's watchword and tomorrow's standard. Complacency makes people fear the unknown, mistrust the untried, and abhor the new. Like water, complacent people follow the easiest course downhill. They draw false strength from looking back, and complacency can apply to individuals and churches and any other area of life. James Emery Wright, or White rather, he gives five dangerous signs of complacency. Let me give them to you. The first sign of complacency, he says, is you're far too easily satisfied. Listen to me. You become happy with incremental growth and minor achievements. Oh, that's a little bit, I've done enough. The second one is that a complacent person, the second symptom is we're quick to make excuses. Quick to make excuses. When you are complacent, you're once very quick to offer all kinds of reasons as to why you are not able to achieve more and greater things in life. Why you can't do anything new. Why that won't work. Your whole theme is why. For the complacent, challenges becomes obstacles rather than opportunities. Listen to me. Obstacles become barriers, and barriers are allowed to become excuses. Let me help some of you unexcuse yourselves. Remember I told you years back that my grandmother got a speeding ticket in her 90s? What I recently found out was that she just got her driver's license when she was 50 years old. What is your excuse for staying where you are? He said, number three, the complacent, there's never enough time. Never enough time. I love it because the complacent, they always complain about the time as though everybody else has been given by God some special dispensation of time. The complacent act as if they are the only ones who ever feel the pressure of time, as though they are the one who God gave less than 24 hours in a day. Everybody read my Pentecostal lips. The anointing has not given me more time. When I hear people who say, I don't have time to get involved in ministry, or I don't have time to get a BA or a master's or a doctoral degree, they don't understand. Don't they understand that I work a job, that I have a family? I don't have time to work. I don't have time to do this. Listen to me. You are no different than the rest of us. I seethe with mild anger because while Ecclesiastes says there is a time for everything under sun, and believe me when I tell you this, timing of birth is certainly important in things, but time is not the issue with the complacent. Values and priorities are your issue. Because what we truly value, we will prioritize and make time for. See, that's why growing up, Lady Brenda and I always had time for our daughters, because we valued it. That's why I've always had time for Lady Brenda, because I value her, I prioritize her. With the complacent, there is never and never will be enough time, nor will there ever be a good time. Let me say something. If your life is moving, most of the time, the things that are worth going after, there's really not a good time for them. Number four, the complacent are no longer teachable. They're no longer teachable. I can always tell when a spirit of complacency has come over a staff person or over a church member. They suddenly know more than me. There's no longer anything I can teach them that I can tell them. When you are complacent, you resist being pushed or challenged. You begin to denounce pushes and challenges as, why is everybody picking on me? Complacent people, someone else is always the issue. Or the student begins to see the flaws in the teacher, and even worse, they begin to reject direction based on their supposed superior knowledge and experience in their field of speciality. Number five, complacent people are content with early success. When you measure everything about your future vision in light of your successes of the past, you have entered the danger zone of complacent. And if you're going to see visions come to pass, you have got to rid yourself not only of people in your life who will bog you down with the attitude of complacency, but you've got to rid yourself of people who are willing to aid you in your attitude of complacency, who will feed you and help you be complacent. James Emery White was also watching ESPN at the gym where he was working out, and there was an interview with Duke coach Mike Krzyzewski, who was at that time once again going to coach the men's Olympic basketball team. He was asked a lot of different questions, but the one that stood out to James White was about LeBron James finally winning his first NBA championship with Miami and how he might compare to Michael Jordan. And Coach K said, and rightfully so, there was no comparing anyone to Michael. But then he said something that the real question is how finally winning a championship would affect LeBron. Would it quell a fire or light a bonfire? For someone like James had craved a title for so long, now that he had it, would he hunger for more or be satisfied and stop trying as hard as he did before? Would it be a catalyst or would it cause him to coast? Listen to me, church. LeBron was 35 years old when he won his fourth championship with the Lakers. In NBA terms, he is considered an old timer. Michael won 6 championships. The great Bill Russell won 11. But here's what I want you to see. When LeBron walked out on that court in that 35-year-old body, he looked like he was 25 years old. When people questioned his chances to win a fourth ring because of age, LeBron refused to coast. He refused to let age be an excuse to become complacent. And he made this statement. He said the LeBron of 35 would dominate the 27-year-old LeBron. See, unlike far too many people in every realm of life, he refused to make excuses and let the fire of vision die in his heart and soul. Vision killers are complacent. Are you your own vision killer? Here's a thought. Proverbs 1:32, it's the only place you find the word complacency. For the waywardness of the inexperienced will kill them, and the complacency of fools will destroy them. A third thing is vision killers are critical. They're critical. 1 Samuel 17:29a. Now before David asked the question, is there no cause, he had to deal with the criticism of his older brother Eliab. And apparently he had to put up with his older brother constantly picking on him. For he said to him, "What have I done now? What did I do this time, big brother?" Now listen to me. Be sure that whenever you catch a vision from God, be prepared to catch criticism from men. Now, let me qualify what I'm about to say. Because there are some folks, they don't want anybody to give them what we all need from time to time. And that is positive, helpful, and sometimes painful criticism. Joseph Parker stepped into the pulpit of the City Temple in London for his Thursday sermon. And he announced that he was under trepidation that day because a letter he had received. It seemed that a gentleman wrote to tell Parker that he would be in the congregation that day with his sole purpose, that of making a philosophical analysis of the sermon. After a long pause, Parker said, "I may add that my trepidation is somewhat mitigated by the fact that the gentleman spells philosophical with an F." I said that to say this. Some people are just downright critical and nasty. But with that, church, every last one of us needs to have people in our lives who will love us enough to give us constructive criticism when we need it. Listen to me. And we need to be mature and secure enough to receive it. Rohrer, Hibbler, and Replogi in Homemade said this. Constructive criticism is an invaluable source of information for those who accept it. But here's what most of us do. We spend more time justifying, excusing, and rationalizing an error than trying to understand the benefit of the criticism. When we are non-defensive, we become aware that constructive criticism is a real compliment. Let me tell you something. When there are people you know who love you, who will criticize you, you know what it means? They see potential in you, and they want to do everything they can to keep the devil from disrupting and destroying that potential in you. Listen now. They said the person offering it is usually uncomfortable in doing so, but if he is willing to endure the discomfort in order to help us, we should listen and appreciate his suggestions, for he runs the risk of arousing our enmity. but he cares enough for our welfare to take the chance. Listen to me, church. Before I go on this point, you and I need to understand it is unhealthy for us, spirit, soul, and body, if we won't allow there to be some people in our lives who can call us on the carpet when we need it and not get offended, or criticize us in a helpful way when we need it, because we all need it from time to time. Abraham Lincoln said he has a right to criticize who has a heart to help us. M. McLaughlin said this: most of us would rather be ruined by praise than helped by criticism. Nobody wants constructive criticism. It's all we can do to put up with constructive praise. But listen to me. When I talk about the reality that vision killers are critical, I'm speaking to the mean-spirited words that are sent forth as heat-seeking missiles with the intention to do harm to your soul and to wound you emotionally, to kill your will, to annihilate the power of vision in your heart and life. And let me talk to you for a minute. Anytime somebody constantly, repeatedly says to you in your face, "I just tell it like it is," be sure there's a heat-seeking missile hiding somewhere in there. Isaac Murray said this: fault-finding is not difficult. He began to tell the story about how a boy had hooked up his dog to the lawnmower. And the dog is pulling the lawnmower while he guides it. And all of a sudden, the dog stopped pulling the lawnmower to bark at a passerby. The boy turns to the passerby who was guiding the lawnmower, and he said, "Don't mind the dog. He's just barking for an excuse to rest. It's easier to bark than to pull the mower." How many of you know some Christians and people that are like that? It's easier to criticize and bark than it is to pull the mower. Samuel Clemens, more commonly known by his pen name Mark Twain, was a gifted writer. Yet Twain had deep contempt for Christianity. He once referred to it as a slaughterhouse religion because of the doctrine of the blood atonement. And he often turned his ridicule on those who believed in the Bible. Then he met and fell in love with Olivia Langdon, a young woman from a good Christian family. While they were courting, he appeared to have downplayed his lack of faith, so she agreed to marry him. You listen to me. That's why the Bible says do not be unequally yoked, single people. After their marriage, Twain began to openly mock Christianity once again. And before too much time passed, Olivia stopped attending church. Now listen to me very closely. It is indeed a dangerous thing for man to make fun of God and to be careless about what they say about the people of God. That's why the Bible says to you, saints, don't worry when people don't talk about when they talk about you. Don't fret because of their evil doings. Twain and his family began to suffer many great reversals, including a complete financial collapse and the death of a beloved daughter. At one point, in attempting to comfort his grieving wife, he said, "Livy, if it comforts you to lean on your faith, do so." She replied sadly, "I cannot. I don't have any faith left." Listen to me again, church. The Apostle Paul is right. There is not one voice that we hear and allow to speak into our lives that is without significance. Listen to the Holy Spirit, the people we spend most of our time with, and our cultural influences such as books and music and social media and television that we allow into our hearts and minds have a dramatic influence on us. This is why Solomon warned of the dangers of spending too much time with those who are evil. In Proverbs 24, 1 through 2, he says, "Don't be envious of evil men, nor desire to be with them, for their heart studies destruction and their lips talk only of mischief." Please get this in your spirit. What enters your ear proceeds to your soul, and what attaches to your soul has the power to determine your destiny and your visions. Watch this now. A study has shown that as much as 77% of everything we think is negative and counterproductive and works against us. People who grow up in an average household hear or are told what they can't do more than 148,000 times by the time they reach age 18. The result: unintentional, negative programming. Watch this now. We take James 3, 9 through 12, much too lightly, where James talks about the power of the tongue to either give life or destroy life. And in verse 8, he says, but the tongue can no man tame. It is full of deadly poison. A man went to dinner with a friend of his. He asked his friend to take him to a restaurant with the best possible meat selection. The friend took him to a restaurant that served tongue, fried tongue, baked tongue, salad tongue, and other tongue. When he asked his friend why he brought him to the restaurant that served tongue as a choice for the best meat, the friend replied, what other meat do you know that can bless you, encourage you, and affirm you? So a little while later, this same man went to dinner with this same friend, and he asked to be taken to a restaurant with the worst meat they could find in hopes of getting a different kind of restaurant. Again, they arrive at the place that served tongue. With a knowing look, his friend looked at him and said, hey, what other meat do you know that can curse you, destroy you, or remove dignity from you? Vision killers. Critical tongue, kill your vision. Number four, vision killers are contagious. 1 Samuel 17, 10 through 11, and then verse 24. And the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. When Saul and all Israel heard those words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and sore afraid. Verse 24, and all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him and were sore afraid. They were so scared. Listen to me. The only thing they could think to do was run. Now let me ask you a question. Where did that spirit of fear come from? It came from their fear-filled leader. His spirit was contagious. It infected them. It got in them. And the critical negative spirit of vision killers works just that way. Let me tell you something. It is viral. It gets into those who are reckless and careless when it comes to relationships that are not positive. Do you understand that relationships are the only virus where you want it to come back positive? I want you to think about that. There's an article by L.A. Kaplan. It's entitled, Why Negative People Are Literally Killing You. New research says that negativity is incredibly harmful and contagious. This is why I keep telling you loving saints that sometimes you've got to realize that you can't help some people until they want help. I don't care if they're related to you. You got to realize that you can't help people. You can't force everybody to get the help they need. And sometimes the best thing you can do is stop trying to help them, because what you have done is opened up yourself continually to being infected by the negative virus in their soul. Now stay with me, because we don't really think about this. The article goes on to say, quite simply, no matter how positive a person you are, negative people can affect your life unless you take the right precautions. The effects are so dramatic that research has shown that even a small amount of negative brain activity can lead to a weakened immune system, making you more prone to illness, and can lead you to heart attack or stroke. That's why 10 years ago more, I made up my mind. I said, let me tell you something, church. I love you, but you're not going to kill me. Listen to me. Again, God told us these things before scientists came out with what people act like is some newfound revelation. That's why Solomon said in Proverbs 4:23, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Look at me, church. Please understand, the most valuable thing that you have is your heart. Please understand that you've got to protect your spiritual and emotional heart if indeed you are going to protect your physical heart. Let me illustrate it this way. Let's say you crack an egg, put it in the skillet, and you start to fry it only to discover it's a rotten egg. The egg is rotten. You can smell it. You can see it. It is obviously a bad egg. Let's say that you then decide to overcome the rotten egg by frying 5 more good eggs with it. So you crack 5 eggs that are healthy and fresh, and you put them in the skillet with the idea that the goodness of the 5 will overcome the badness of the 1. Well, I got bad news for you today. It is not the righteous eggs, the good ones, that will override the diseased one. It is the diseased one that will penetrate the good, contaminating even the good and making it sick. Do you see the correlation? And vision killers are contagious like a rotten egg. Number 5, vision killers are corrosive. 1 Samuel 17:28, and Eliab, his eldest brother, heard when he spake unto the men. And Eliab's anger was kindled against David, and he said, "Why did you come down here? With whom have you left those few sheep? I know your pride and the haughtiness of your heart. The only reason you came down here was to see the battle." Now, I said it's corrosive. What does it mean to be corrosive? Gradually destructive, steadily harmful, tending to eat away or consume, working even as acid that cannot be seen. Let me tell you what I believe. Eliab was not only the oldest brother, but he was also very, very angry, because being the first child, he was the first one to hear God tell Samuel he is not the one to replace Saul. And if that was not bad enough, then he had to stand there and he had to watch and see as Samuel announces that the little baby brother, the little rat of a runt, the pretty boy who is not even old enough to join the army, that he will be the one who sits on the throne. And I think that he did just like Saul. He thought, "My God, what more can he have but the kingdom?" And I just think in his mind's eye, he says, "I'm not going to let that happen. I'm just going to keep on criticizing him until I begin to corrode his spirit, until I begin to erode his will. And if I talk about him badly enough, long enough, I will cause him to lose sight of the vision of the throne." There is an article called Fontana's 8 Forms of Corrosion. And there is one form that caught my attention more than others. It is called pitting. Pitting is one of the most destructive and insidious forms of corrosion. It causes equipment to fail because of perforation, with only a small percent of weight loss in the entire structure. It is often difficult to detect pits because they're small size, because the pits are often covered by corrosion protecting products. Somehow the pit has the ability to get underneath the corrosion protection and begin to erode the whole project. Listen to me very closely, church. Most vision killers work the same way as pitting corrosion. They say and they do things that seem so small and of no consequence that the negativity of their words and deeds are difficult to detect. Why is that? Because they say subtle little things that sound spiritual, that sound helpful, that are wrapped up in corrosive protective products called the Word of God. They have great theology, but their theology does not change them. When in essence, they are slowly eroding away your confidence and vision, they begin to murmur and throw out little sarcastic remarks, remarks that slowly wear you down. Listen to me. One pastor, his board would sit in the room and they would eat him alive, and then they turn right around and say, "But pastor, you have great potential in you." Listen to me. If you are going to see vision come to pass, you cannot be as our soon-to-be former president. I love him, but he is the proof that you cannot allow your emotions to so run your life that you feel the need to respond to every negative remark. Watch me now. I love what Warren Buffett said. He said, "You will continue to suffer if you have an emotional reaction to everything that is said to you. True power is sitting back and observing things with logic. True power is restraint." Watch now. If words control you, that means that everyone can control you. Breathe and allow things to pass. You must not, church, allow criticism of people to corrode your spirit. Don't let their words eat away at your visions and dreams. Number 6, vision killers are carnal. 1 Samuel 17:25a. And the men of Israel said, have you not seen this man that has come up? Surely to defy Israel is why he has come up. I want you to listen to me. We're not simply talking about a natural army here, church. We're talking about the army that David rightly defined in 1 Samuel 17:45. When he said to Goliath, you come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. Listen to what he said. This is not a natural army. They're on the Lord's side and the Lord's on their side. David said, I know you're big and intimidating, but I'm not afraid of you. And the reason I'm not afraid of you is that I am viewing you through the lens of the eyes of the God who is the Lord of hosts, who is the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. Now listen to me very closely. The carnal always see things, even in the spirit, through the natural eye. They always see things through the eyes of the flesh, and therefore they never ever, listen, every time they don't get a vision from God to overcome their enemies. Listen now. Vision is not simply, I saw something. Vision is seeing what God sees the way he sees it. Vision is seeing what God sees the way he sees it. And that army, unlike David, they saw Goliath through the eyes of the flesh. They saw him through the natural eye. They saw him through their own eye. But David looked at Goliath, and he saw Goliath through God's eyes, the God of the great universe, the great I am. And when he saw him as God saw him. And David said, this dude is big, but thank God, God is bigger. And that dude is so big, I can't miss him. He's going down because he saw it through the eyes of the Spirit. When your vision is from God, it will move you from being the victim to being the victor. Vision killers are carnal. They see everything through the eyes of the flesh because, number seven, vision killers are cadavers. Cadavers. Yes, I love that word. 1 Samuel 16:14 and verse 23. But the spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled Saul. Verse 23, and it came to pass when the evil spirit from God was upon Saul that David took out an harp and played with his hand. So Saul was refreshed as well, and the evil spirit departed from Saul. I want you to see this. Saul is in the spirit realm a cadaver. He is the king of the walking dead. Many people are vision killers because they are carnal, and they are carnal because in the spirit realm they are dead. They are cadavers. Cadavers comes from the Latin word cadere, meaning to fall. From that comes the word cadaverous, resembling a cadaver. And a cadaveric spasm is a muscle spasm that causes the dead body to twitch and jerk, giving off to the uninformed and uneducated the sense that there might be life in that body. Listen to me, there are a lot of spiritual cadavers when it comes not only to vision, but to their walk and relationship with Almighty God. They jerk and they twitch. They have great moments of emotional spasms during praise and worship, which far too many interpret as a sign of spiritual life, when the fact of the matter is that they are full of dead men's bones. As Jesus said, they are white as sepulchres, pretty on the outside, great performance, but full of dead men's bones. Cadavers, a lot of jerk and twitch, but no revelation, no spiritual eyesight. They never see what you see. They never come to the place of being in relationship with God that allows them to have such vision as to see what God sees. Now I got to wrap this up quickly. Here's my conclusion today. Number one, vision must be driven by a kingdom agenda. Vision must be driven. It must be birthed in you by the Holy Spirit. It must be more than you coming up with some good idea or what seems like a right solution to your dilemma. 1 Samuel 17:44-47, when you read that portion of scripture, there is something very telling. It is that when David went out, he took out the big boy and he got the victory that saved all of Israel. He was successful in doing so because he was driven by a kingdom agenda. He understood that it wasn't just about this one army and this one fight, but that it was about the whole nation of Israel and the future fights. He had not fought and won that battle, he understood that if he didn't do it, then somebody else would come along and they would have the same mentality that you can just pick on God's army anytime you want to. But listen, church, he understood something else that he didn't fully understand, but he had a picture of this. He understood that if he doesn't win this battle, he does not sit on the throne of King David as the king over Israel and the bloodline through which Jesus Christ would come. His bloodline would be cut off. I want you to see what I'm trying to convey. If David gets knocked off, there goes God's plan for redemption. Well, you say, but God would have had plan B. No, God does not operate with plans B and C. He has one plan, and the prophecy would not have been fulfilled. And I'm going to say these things one more time. These days that we are about to enter into, get it in your spirit. They will be days of opportunities to hear and receive powerful vision from God. It is imperative that we all prostrate ourselves in a position that we begin to hear the Holy Spirit more clearer than ever before. I still believe that God uses the prophets and the prophetic, and it is needed in our times more than ever. But with that said, we have heard a lot of prophetic voices in these recent days, some who have repented and some who still should repent. Because so many said that God told them that President Trump would be reelected. So many others told us things that they said God told them and they never came to pass. But rather than criticizing them, what I'm trying to get across to you is I hope we've learned something in the kingdom of God. And I hope that we will learn that even in the future, God will speak through the prophetic, through the ministry of the prophetic by way of the prophets. But yet I hope that we have learned that we must never let the words of others cause us to relinquish the privilege and the responsibility to hear the voice of God for ourselves. I got to quit. Well, let me say this. Many years ago, a young man who applied for a job as a Morse code operator answering an ad in the newspaper went to the address that was listed. When he arrived, he entered a large, noisy office. In the background, a telegraph was clacking away. A sign on the receptionist counter instructed the applicants to fill out a form and wait until they were summoned to enter the inner office. The young man completed his form and sat down with the seven other applicants. After a few minutes, the young man stood up, crossed the room to the door into the inner office, and walked right in. Naturally, the other applicants perked up, wondering what was going on. Why did this young man, why had he been so bold? They muttered among themselves that they hadn't heard a summons yet. And they took their more than a little satisfaction, assuming that the young man who went into the office would be reprimanded for his presumption and summarily be disqualified for the job. Within a few minutes, that young man emerged into the inner office, escorted by the interviewer, who announced to the other applicants, "Gentlemen, thank you very much for coming, but the job has been filled by this young man." The other young applicants began to grumble to each other, and then one spoke up and said, "Wait a minute, I don't understand. He was the last one to come in, and we never got our chance to be interviewed, yet he got the job. That is not fair." The employer responded, "While you have sat there, the telegraph has been ticking out the following message. If you understand this message, then come right in. The job is yours." We are entering a day where those who are attuned to the Spirit of God will not only see what others don't see, but you'll hear what others don't hear. Here's my close. Vision driven by God's word will outlive the visionary. When you get a word from God concerning a vision, it will outlive you. Listen now. I know that there is still a lot of racial division in this country. They will be there until Jesus comes, and we must not stop the fight. But we have gone too far in many cases in this country, listen to me, where somehow we are able to make race an issue even when the true issue is not racism. Because we are so bent on being politically correct that every issue that is an issue, some way, somehow, we're going to figure out how to make it a race issue. And what we're not realizing is that it is causing us to forget that though we're not where we should be, we're not where we used to be. Thanks be to God for Dr. Martin Luther King and those who were with him. Some still alive and some who, like he, laid down their lives. Thanks be to God. We are far from where we used to be. And I said that to say this. A demon-possessed man, driven by a demon-possessed agenda, shot and killed a dreamer, killed the visionary. But can I tell you, I got excited when I realized that in April, 53 years later, we celebrate the reality that when a vision comes from God, a man, a woman gets a word from God. You may kill the visionary, but the vision lives on. If you believe that, give God glory.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. 2021 is the year of new vision, new voice, and new victory. And you will not be able to receive it if you are in an atmosphere of vision killers. Amen? Amen. Well, good morning, Eagle Heights family. My name is Pastor Stefan, and I'm the youth pastor here at Eagle Heights Cathedral. And it is time to give the Lord his tithe in our offering. Amen. Amen. Today's special offering will be for the Joash chest. And with the Joash chest, we use that to do anything that pertains to the physical building, including the parking lot. And I also want to remind you guys that March is Sanctity of Life Month, where life is celebrated. Every year we give to support your options, formerly known as a woman's concern and support against abortion. If you want to give to that, if you would just make your check out to Eagle Heights Cathedral and note that it's for that, that would be amazing. Amen. Before I pray, I just want to encourage you guys with a quick story, because, you know, I like to tell stories. That's just me. A few months ago, every Saturday I wake up, I go clean my car. That's just it's a given. It's what I do. That's just who I am. And I remember one Saturday I got up, I got in my truck, I'm driving up Route 1 North, and God spoke to me. God said, Stefan, I want you to give $1,000 into the Joash chest. I said, God, can we go on like a layaway plan, maybe like 200 here, and you know, we could work something out. And I did what any Christian pastor would do. I ignored what God told me. The rest of the day, God was hounding me. My stomach was tight. My heart was racing all day. Finally, dinner time, Cassandra and I sit down, and I said, babe, I said, God's spoken to me. God's been speaking this to me all day. I have to do it. She looks at me. She says, babe, God spoke the exact same thing to me this morning. I was like, all right. I didn't know, Pastor Lopez, you were going to announce that we were going to start building the wall the next day. So Sunday, we're here. Pastor Lopez says, hey, we're going to start receiving offerings so that we could build a wall. So Cassandra and I, we look at each other and we start laughing. And then I get a text message from one of my tenants saying the fridge was broken. So like many of us in the kingdom of God, I was tempted to cut back on God when things got tight. But then I made a decision in my heart that I wasn't going to do so. So after church, I go home to change so I can go deal with that situation. And I remember Cassandra sat in the truck outside, and I went upstairs to go change. So then I come back out. I walk out of the apartment. She's honking, beep, 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 beep. And my first thought, I'm annoyed. I'm like, babe, there's white people around. We can't be those black people. Relax. So then I get in the truck, and she's almost to tears. She's like, babe, someone just walked up to this truck and said, hey, I've been meaning to give this to you, and handed her a check for $2,000. I say all that to say this, Bishop. God provided for a need before I even knew I had it, because I made a decision in my heart that I was going to sow into the kingdom. So I want to encourage you, no matter what spot you're in right now, God wants to provide for that need. Father, I pray for every single person in this room, Lord, whatever it is that you're encouraging them to give. I pray, Lord, that they would hear your voice, and God, they would be obedient, because God, you are Jehovah Jireh, and Lord, you never, ever leave your people hanging. Father, we thank you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, church. Why don't you just stand with us and let's give God some glory before we head out today. Our God has been so faithful to us. No matter what we have been through in this last year, he still is King of Kings. He is still Lord of Lords. So we just want to take a moment and collectively tell him that great are you, Lord. Everybody just say, great are you, Lord. Say, great are you, Lord. Hallelujah. Here we go.
Holy God Almighty, it's a privilege to worship you, Maker of the universe. It's an honor just to stand before you. Holy, holy God Almighty, it's a privilege to worship you, Maker of the universe. an honor just to stand before you. With a grateful heart, I lift my hands to you, proclaiming, Lord, you reign. With a grateful heart, I lift my hands to you, proclaiming, Lord, you reign. Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised. Father, you reign. Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised. Father, you reign. Lord, you reign. With a grateful heart,
with a grateful heart, I lift my
hand and I proclaim,
proclaiming, Lord, you reign.
Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised. Father, you reign. Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. To be praised, Father, you reign. Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised, Father, you reign. Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised, Father, you reign. Father, you reign. Lord, you reign.
With a grateful heart, with a grateful heart, I lift my hands
and I proclaim, proclaiming, Lord, you reign. Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised. Father, you reign. Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised, Father, you reign. Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised, Father, you reign. Great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised, Father, you reign.
Church, and because the Father reigns, but he also reigns in you, you can go out and not just be the difference, you can make a difference. Go out and kill some giants. Take them out in this coming week. Now throw your hands toward heaven. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace.
Eagle Heights Cathedral, thank you again for choosing to worship with us today. I want to remind you that you can register online at ehconline.org to attend services with us in person. Services are at 8:30, 10:15, and 12 p.m. Registrations open tomorrow morning at midnight, and they run until Thursday night at 11:59. We look forward to seeing you soon.